Hey, good evening. I want to talk to you today about a spirit that I feel like we don't hear much about. Now, me personally, I feel like we talk about the Jezebel spirit way too much, as if she's just responsible for everything wrong in the world right now. There are very, very much bigger things. However, I just want to mention something that I feel like is not talked about a lot, as far as causing chaos and trying to bring accusations into the leadership that God appointed, and that is Moses's cousin Korah or Korach. So his story is elaborated in Numbers chapter 16. I don't know how much of this I'll actually read, but I'll probably read from 1 to 11. So now, Korach was the son of Yitzhar, the son of Kahat, the son of Levi, along with Dathan and Avilam, the sons of Eliab and On, the son of Pelet, descendants of Reuven, took men and rebelled against Moshe, who was Moses. Siding with them were 250 men of Israel, leaders of the community, key members of the council, men of reputation. They assembled themselves against Moshe and Aaron and said to them, "You take too much on yourselves. After all, the entire community is holy, every one of them, and Adonai is among them. So why do you lift yourselves up above Adonai's assembly?" When Moshe heard this, he fell on his face. Then he said to Korach and his whole group, "In the morning, Adonai will show who are his and who is the holy person he will allow to approach him. Yes, he will bring whomever he chooses near to himself. Do this. Take censers, Korach, and all your group. Put fire in them and put incense in them before Adonai tomorrow. The one whom Adonai chooses will be the one who is holy. It is you, you sons of Levi, who are taking too much on yourselves." Then Moshe said to Korach, "Listen here, you sons of Levi. Is it for you a mere trifle that the God of Israel has separated you from the community of Israel to bring you close to himself so that you can do the work in the tabernacle of Adonai and stand before the community serving them? He has brought you close and all your brothers, the sons of Levi, with you. Now you want the office of Kohen to the office of the priest. That's why you and your group have gathered together against Adonai. After all, what is Alon that you complain against him?" So, to give you some backstory on who Korach is, he was a family member of Moses. He was his cousin, and he was responsible for keeping the articles that were in the temple, the tabernacle, that was still in attendance at this particular point in history. If you go to Numbers chapter 3, and you look at verses 27 to, I'd say, 31, it gives you a brief history. So Korach came from Kahat, as it mentions in number 16, and these men, it says in verse 31, they were responsible for the ark, the table, the menorah, or the candlestand, which basically is something similar to this, similar, because this is a Hanukkah. But just to give you a visual. Oh, goodness. The altars, the utensils that the Kohanim, the priests, use when they serve in the holy place, the curtain, and everything involved with the maintenance of these things. Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the Kohen, was first among the chiefs of the Levi'im, the Levites, and supervised those in charge of the holy place. So, the Levites, what Moses was essentially saying in his argument in number 16 was that, number one, the Lord separated you. Now, the Levites, the Levi'im, were separated by God, and these were the priesthood. This is where the priesthood came from. And so when they came to the giving of the inheritance of the land of Israel, they did not receive an inheritance. The Lord said that he was their inheritance. They served the Lord. And so Moses basically said, "Is this not good enough for you?" And not only that, but they were responsible for the articles that were actually in the tabernacle, a very prestigious honor, and one that not everyone could, you know, take upon themselves. Like, you couldn't just wake up one day and say, "You know what? I'm going to be a Levite. I'm going to start working in the temple." You couldn't do that. And so this really sounds Luciferian to me when you take into consideration the nature of Satan right before his fall. We see this in operation specifically in Korach and those that were with him. So just to give you a little context of what I mean, Isaiah chapter 14, let's start at verse 12. How you have fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to the heavens. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the Mount of Assembly, on the utmost heights of Mount Sophon. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. If that's not convincing enough, consider Ezekiel chapter 28. I'm probably hopping around here, starting at verse 12. Man, sound a lament over the king of Tyre. And I'm not kidding, it actually says, it just says, man. Sound a lament over the king of Tyre and say to him, thus said the master, the Lord, man, you are the sealer of the plan. Full of wisdom, perfect in beauty, in Eden, the garden of God you were. Every precious stone was in your raiment. Skipping to verse 14. On the day you were created, they were made. You were a cherub, anointed and sheltering. And I set you on a holy mountain. And I'm going to skip to verse 17. Your heart grew haughty through your beauty. You ruined your wisdom together with your splendor. I flung you to the ground. Before kings, I set you to be stared at. And so basically, what I believe it's doing is basically like giving like a job description of the devil. And none of that was good enough for him. He wanted to make himself like God, which is why we see him trying to sell that to Adam and Eve in the garden. Because when you're in deception about who you really are, you go look for other people to sign them up along, to be deceived along with you. You'll get that tomorrow. So, let's see. It reminds me of a couple other people. For example, Judas, you know, you have to realize being in ministry with Jesus, you had direct access to God. You know, that's why some of John's disciples were upset, because, you know, they didn't have to fast because you literally had God right there. So if you had a question, you could have just asked him. But none of that was good enough. You know, Jesus imparted unto them. He set them out. He made them, you know, apostles. They worked miracles. They saw healings. They preached. They cast, you know, demons out of people. But it wasn't good enough for Judas. And so he was deceived in his heart and thought it was good for him to basically give up the location of where Jesus was at for money. It wasn't good enough for him. And so this is just a couple of things that that I see. And one of the other things that seems to be, I guess, natural to the spirit of Korach is basically accusation, because his accusation towards Moses was that they had appointed themselves to where they were. And so he goes and he gets, you know, two other men, and behind them is 250 other people. And what that shows us is that rebellion always seeks a party, but it always seeks a community. Rebellion is never satisfied by itself, you know. It always tries to go, it tries to go find other people and say, you know, hey, you know, what about this guy? You know, who does he think he is? And that's basically what was arguing. You know, who do you think you are that you made yourself like this? But opposing the leadership is a form of rebellion. It's not even a personal problem, you know, towards those people, but it's rebellion, you know, towards God, because God appointed, you know, Moses and Aaron. And if you really do the research and you do the history, Moses didn't even want this. You know, our first introduction to him and his relationship with God is him arguing with God and trying to find a loophole so God can go get somebody else. So Moses didn't even want this. A lot of people who are truly called by God don't even want the calling that they have. But from the outside looking in, it seems like, you know, we're just, you know, power hungry. And I love how, look how sneaky it is. You know, sometimes rebellion will seek to usurp someone, and it might sound like genuine care or concern. He said in verse 3, this is Korach, you take too much on yourselves. Almost as if to say, you know, hey, man, you know, you got too much going on. You know, don't worry about it. We're all qualified. Now, here's the thing, and this is a lot of this is something that a lot of people in the church don't like to hear. Yes, we all are called by God. We are all loved by God. You know, God loves me just as much as he loves a boy in Indonesia that's never even heard of Jesus. You know, irrespective of what I'm doing, irrespective of what he may or may not be doing, he loves us the same. I have a calling. He has a calling. We all have a calling. We're all here for a purpose. However, not all of our purpose is the same exactly. All our assignments aren't the same. And so you have to be careful about wanting what somebody else has just because of how it looks, because you don't know the warfare it took for them to even walk in that assignment. You know, Moses' preparation was not very ideal. He was in the wilderness for like 40 years by himself, you know, living a normal life, and then God called him. You have to think about him having to confront, you know, principalities, having to confront Pharaoh and to get backlash from him, to get backlash from the people. Your life is always being threatened, not only by Pharaoh, but also by the people that you're called to lead, which, you know, a little side note there, sometimes when you are called to be a leader, sometimes the people may not really discern who you are supposed to be to them, and that sometimes, you know, in their ignorance or in their soul trauma, they might try to kill you, but of course the hand of the Lord will be upon you. So they didn't really fully know what Moses took to even get there. And so Korah is basically like, you know, hey, we're all called, you know, we could all do this, and that is not the same. That is not true. Just because you're a man of God, you know, maybe he, you know, is a pastor, that doesn't mean that I should stand up in the congregation and say, you know, hey, who made you a pastor? You know, I could pastor too. And that's just not true. We are all called by God. We all have our different gifts. Don't get me wrong. We're all called. We all have our gifts, but we're not all called to do the same thing. You know, the analogy that I have is, you know, I think about an army. An army is, yes, very, they're supposed to be one, but at the same time, an army is diverse, and it's that diversity that makes it so strategic against the enemy. You know, if we're an army, we can't all be snipers. We can't all be on a roof, you know, and we can't all be on the front line. You know, some of us need to be on land. Some of us would be better fit in water. Some of us would be better fit in the air. We can't all be, you know, snugged up in a corner saying, well, I'm a sniper. Well, you can't be a sniper. I want to be a sniper too. It doesn't work like that. And we are basically subject to whatever place that the Father has set us. If the Father has set you on the roof to be a sniper, you don't need to go and try and be a general on land. If the Lord sets you in a submarine underwater, you don't need to go find a jet somewhere and say, you know what, well, he's doing this, why can't I fly too? It don't work like that. So basically, I love Moses' response in verse 4. It says, when Moshe heard this, he fell on his face. Then he said to Korach and his whole group, in the morning, Adonai will show who are his and who is the holy person he will allow to approach him. How I see this is the perfect response to demonic accusation. You fall on your face before the Lord. This would have been the perfect time for Moses to give a great speech about who he was, how many miracles he performed, the whole Red Sea scenario. He could have did that, but instead he falls on his face. Remember, the scripture said that he was the most humble man on the face of the earth. And long story short, and if you go to the end of this chapter, we know that Korach and all that were with him, the earth literally swallows them up, and they go alive into Sheol, into the place of the dead, which I see to say that basically the spirit, it's very dangerous to be around, because not only will that person be consumed, but even the people around that person who's housing that spirit, because again, rebellion always seeks a party. So this is destructive, not just for a person, but this can destroy a whole community. But also, it's very much not wise to flex your qualifications before the Lord. Again, look at the posture of Moses. Majority of the people that were calling the Bible, none of them were like, oh yeah, Lord, you definitely got the right guy right here. It's never wise to go before the Lord in the strength of who you are, because even who you are is because of him. But when you do that, when you flex like that before the Lord, he is obligated to crush you. And by that, I mean basically obligated to show you, hey, you're not the one in charge. And if you do that, if you you basically will be swallowed up. And again, opposition towards and rebellion towards the leadership of the Lord is rebellion to God himself, because it shows that you don't trust his judgment and that you don't trust the character of God. Remember, I believe it was Paul that said to basically submit yourselves to the ones who have to give an account for your soul. And so some people just see people in leadership as if like, a place of influence. But no, when you're in leadership, I'm accountable for not only what I do in my personal spare time, but also how I stewarded you. And so rebelling against them is rebelling against God, because God sets leadership over us to help mature us, to help grow us. And if you rebel against that, you will be swallowed up. And so I hope this makes sense. This is a crash course on the spirit of Korach. It's one that seeks accusation against leadership, and definitely seeks a party and disguises itself. So yeah, I hope this makes sense.